Welcome to Fort Hall Forum. Wow. Before we begin, I have just a few announcements. Fort Hall Forum tonight, Modern Muslims in a Modern World at the Modern Theater, will be on videotape, and it will be available on YouTube in just a couple of weeks. If you'd like to be alerted when the video is uploaded to YouTube, please do visit youtube.com. Ford Hall, I think we're Forum 1908. That's when we started in 1908. Subscribe to our channel. Please do mute your phones now. You are welcome to live tweet this forum, but I will also be live tweeting it, so it might be redundant. When it comes time for questions, there is a microphone, standing microphone right there. We ask that you walk up to the microphone and speak directly into it so that everyone in the theater can hear you, but also so that we can pick you up on the videotape. If you prefer not to stand up and you have a smartphone with you, you may tweet your questions to hashtag FHF, as in Ford Hall Forum, and I'll repeat that right before we start taking questions so you don't have to remember it. Ford Hall Forum at Suffolk University is made possible by the generous donations of the Lowell Institute. It's also made possible by our generous members. So if you're not yet a member of Ford Hall Forum, please do pick up an envelope on your way out. Tonight we bring to you Modern Muslims in a Modern World. Reverend Amy Fisher, who's the chaplain here at Suffolk University, will give you her short bio herself. Please welcome Amy Fisher.
Thank you. Thank you very much. My bio is very short, as my class in the back will attest. I am Reverend Amy Fisher. I am the United Methodist clergy person on assignment to be the university chaplain and the director of the Interfaith Center at Suffolk University. We take very seriously our commitment to coexistence at the Interfaith Center. We provide all manner of religious life every week, including Quran study, Hillel meetings with the Torah study. We provide Christian Bible study. We provide vinyasa yoga. We provide Shambhala Buddhist meditation. So everything coexists in the Interfaith Center. So tonight we are very happy to be here as the Interfaith Center representative, providing the moderation for this discussion. So please let me ask you to welcome our guests who have taken time tonight to come and be with us. Can we give them some welcome? Thank you. So as the university chaplain at Suffolk, one who deals with every single religion on a daily basis, my first question to you is a very general one, but please take it very thoughtfully. Could we start with you, Barbara, and move down the line, and tell us a bit about yourself, give us your name, a little bit of your background, and tell us why you even agreed to join us for this conversation. Please take your time, Barbara.
Good evening, everybody. I am an educator. I've been a language arts teacher for middle school students. You can't hear me? And I have continued teaching outside the classroom now that I've left my teaching assignment. But I'm here today because I believe that Muslims ourselves need to be part of the conversation about who Muslims are. And if we're not helping to redefine what it means to be Muslim, then who's going to do that? And so for me, this is a calling, I guess, more than anything else. I feel it's a duty as an American citizen, but also as a Muslim, to be out there and helping to demystify so many of the misconceptions that exist about Muslims. So I'm happy for the opportunity to be here today.
Can you tell us a bit more about your work before we move on?
Sure. I have worked with Muslim youth, and my most recent work has been on collecting narratives by young Muslims. It's a project that I started called Muslim Youth Voices. And I've been collecting these narratives from Muslims in middle school, high school, and college to write about what it's like from their perspective being Muslim in America. And I've gotten some really amazing testimonies. These are really counter narratives. And so they're efforts by these young Muslims to sort of push back against the assumptions that they're facing on a daily basis, whether it's in schools or in their neighborhoods or just every time they turn on the TV or open a newspaper. And so it's adding nuance to what it means to be a Muslim. And I'm using these in several different ways. One of them is in interfaith conversations, but I'm also using them for educators and for students to help give a glimpse into what life is really like for a person who's Muslim, so that we don't just put a label on somebody and think that we know. And so that, again, it's very much in line with my own individual work, and it's the idea of sort of mobilizing each individual Muslim to sort of portray themselves.
Thank you, Barbara, and thank you again for coming. Mona, would you tell us a bit about yourself and why you agreed to join us for this conversation?
Yeah, for sure. So my name is Mona Haydar, and I grew up in Flint, Michigan, and I'm a performance poet, an artist, and mother to a two-year-old who is at home right now, probably getting ready for bedtime. But I'm soon to be a divinity student at Union Theological Seminary in New York City. I'm really excited about that. But I've been performing poetry for almost 12 years now, so it's been a profession and beyond that, a passion. And why I wanted to come here tonight, well, first of all, thank you for the invitation. I'm really excited to be here and to have this conversation. And I just really like talking about this kind of stuff with everybody and anybody, and I think if you kind of, you'll hear more about my husband and I. We did this thing in Cambridge where we talked to people on the streets and handed out donuts, and we just wanted to talk to people. So we're just two people who kind of just like to talk to people. So that's why we're here. I'm here.
Thank you for coming to talk to us tonight. We definitely appreciate it. Sebastian, can you tell us a bit about yourself and why you agreed to join us tonight for this conversation?
Sure. You know, kind of came into this role as an activist very accidentally through this project that my wife and I came up with right after the attacks in Paris and San Bernardino, where we were just, I think like a lot of people, just kind of paralyzed by disbelief and depression and this feeling of impotence, not knowing what to do. So we came up with this very kind of whimsical idea that we were just going to go out and talk to people and maybe just solve all the world's problems through conversation and caffeine and sugar. And you know, I think we maybe changed one person's mind, but it really did this, got us out there and talking to people. And so, you know, with this, most recent wave of Islamophobia, you know, I've been in this very interesting position of being a practicing Muslim, but also having family and also most of my life kind of from the dominant white, educated, upper middle class culture that you know, sees this religion kind of from the outside, and then yet at the same time I'm inside of it and practicing it and understanding it. So I'm kind of on this, you know, bi-level of this disbelief at the level of ignorance, and also being able to have a little bit of compassion for that ignorance, because that was me, sort of, you know, not too long ago. So I'm trying to kind of come at it from both viewpoints. And like Mona said, just really happy to share our story and really interested in talking as myself, not as some spokesperson for Islam, not as any sort of expert, but trying to use my story to, you know, help break down some myths and really make connections. And that's kind of been at the heart of our project, is just connecting with people at a heart level. And most of those conversations actually had very little to do with Islam per se. They just happened to be with two people who happened to be Muslims. And so just happy to continue that tonight. So thanks for braving the horrible weather and, you know, welcoming us.
We'd love to hear more about your project in a moment.
Great.
Let me cool. Move down and ask Nadeem, can you tell us a bit about yourself and why you agreed to join us this evening, besides the fact that your father is a professor here and a very dear friend of mine?
I actually kind of have a policy of yes. So I try to say yes and show up the same way I think the rest of the panelists have said. You know, we show up. We join the conversation. Frankly, I show up even when it's like a conservative radio commentator with gotcha questions asking. And I think that's important. For about a generation or two, our Muslim predecessors, leaders in the community, have traditionally balked at something that has an implied level of offensiveness. And for the first time, I think, we're all joining ranks as a generation and stepping forward. There's still a few leaders in the community, even young leaders, who are just playing it safe and this isn't fair and we're not going to participate. But for the most part, we are participating and we're changing minds very rapidly. I think I came out of my most recent, you said you convinced one person, maybe I've convinced one person too, and maybe that's all that's two. But maybe that's all we need. The one I convinced is, has the ears of hundreds of thousands, if not millions, all over the country, syndicated all over the country, and he came away saying, I think we've established a totally different level of communication, and I came away with some respect. So I came away with some respect, he came away with some respect, and there was a lot more understanding. I think we have to do a lot more of that. And in terms of who I am, I'm a city councilor in Cambridge. I squeaked into office by 6 votes the first time I was elected, and then topped the ticket the most recent time based on a strategy of real engagement, not just during election season, but year-round, and an interest in economic and educational equity, really attacking social inequity and problematic economic basis that cities like Cambridge and other opulent cities all over the world are facing, where really most of the working class doesn't get a fair shake.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So we had quite the debate in the Interfaith Center going today about which question I should ask next. So we had a toss-up between the next two questions. So pretend I asked the first one first and the second one second, or the second one first and this. Yeah. So let me just pick one and see where you go with that. So given the title of this conversation, we decided to ask, and we'll go this direction, Barbara, would you consider yourself a modern Muslim?
Well, I actually was thinking about that.
Yes,
before
we
you
were
asked,
too.
because I, you know, what does it mean to be modern?
Mm-hmm.
Modern anything. Every age thinks that they're the modern one, right? And so I think there may be some baggage associated with that word. I mean, what does it mean to be a modern person? Does it mean we use technology or we drive everywhere instead of walking, or we have all the modern conveniences? I'm not sure. Or is it a state of mind? For me, being modern means not being so insulated or so isolated that I can think that I'm self-sufficient. It means that I understand that I am living in coexistence with many others who come from many different backgrounds and different viewpoints, but that we somehow all need each other and that we can benefit from interacting with each other. And so I have no desire to go, retreat to some earlier time. I'm living in the here and now, and if that makes me modern, then I'll take it. But I think that's about what I would say to your question.
Mona, are you a modern Muslim? And what does that mean?
Well, I think it's a really interesting question because delineating between modern and moderate, I think that's a really interesting topic. Like, I don't want to be called a moderate Muslim just because I'm a Muslim. And I think, saying that I'm moderate or saying that I'm extremist or saying that I'm, hippie or saying whatever, crunchy or whatever, those kinds of labels are I think destructive and divisive and separating. And one of the things that I'm really interested in is bringing people together. And so while yes, I am a moderate Muslim and I am a crunchy hippie mother to a child who I wish, would just never have to have a diaper because of the environmental damage that it does, in landfills and things like that. Anyway, so I'm really interested in words. And so mm-hmm. modernity and post-modernity and what those words actually mean. Yeah, I'm modern. I'm wearing nail polish. I have an iPhone. And, I like my stilettos. And, there's so much more to me. And I don't see myself as just modern or just whatever. Obviously, I believe in a set way of life that speaks to me and informs me on, you know, particularly how I dress. And people, some people see that as not modern.
Yeah.
That I can't be a modern woman dressed the way I'm dressed. And I'm always like, well, I can be an American woman expressing my freedom as an American to dress however I want and call myself modern because that's America. And I'm proud to be part of that legacy and part of that. So am I modern? Yeah, and I'm a lot of things. I'm a lot of things. Yeah.
Words are very important, which is why we were talking about that question. Sebastian, are you a modern Muslim?
Yeah, I wish I wasn't. I kind of, you know, a lot of people want to live, you know, in the time of the Prophet, or, you know, I still have this very anachronistic sense. I want to be like Walden. I want to get rid of all the technology, and I, you know, I debate with my wife all the time about wanting to live this life that is just now impossible. I don't know if you guys saw, what was that Woody Allen movie, Midnight in Paris? I can really relate to that. I'm like, oh, life must have been better, you know, before electricity and running water and when everyone had lice and disease. I'm sure I would have been happier, you know. But yes, I am. I remember when cell phones were first popular, some of the images that were, I saw a lot in like Life and Time magazine would be this woman in a burqa, you know, talking on a cell phone in some modern city, you know, in Iran or Afghanistan, as if those things were just completely incompatible, right? Just, you know, as if a Muslim, especially one who dressed with a complete covering, couldn't possibly have a cell phone number and know how to text and, you know, be gossiping with their friends. And I think that the very question implies that Muslims somehow aren't compatible with a modern world, right? That we live in this time where women dress differently and men have these very old school beliefs. And I really fell prey to some of that when I first met Mona. You know, the fact that she was interested in hip-hop music and permaculture and knew, you know, all kinds of things that I had no idea about. I just had this idea that Muslims talked about Muslim things and did Muslim things and read Muslim books and talked only to other Muslims and they ate Muslim food, whatever that was, you know. And even though I was probably more open-minded about Islam because I had friends who converted and various life experiences that I had, I really did have this stereotype of this sort of these sort of cloistered communities. And it's true, one of the strengths of Muslims in America is that they live in very tight communities. But, you know, it's funny, I think a lot of Americans, non-Muslim Americans think, you know, Muslims are just so different, they're alien, they're just this kind of part of this belief that can't interact with America. And one of my main criticisms of modern Muslims in America is just how American they are. They're just terribly successful and very educated and very materialistic, and they live in giant, beautiful homes and drive fancy cars, you know. And so one of my criticisms was just like that they've all kind of made the American dream, like hook, line, and sinker, and they're more American than most Americans want to be. And yet our stereotype is just sort of this, you know, very backward, slow, you know, slow to catch up culture, which is just couldn't be further from the truth, at least in this country. You know, we're really blessed in this country to have this very, very educated, very successful, extremely integrated community, and yet somehow we're seen as not meshing in some ways. And so I think a lot of people would be surprised about just how modern and just how woven into the fabric America is. So I think, I don't know if we have a choice anymore, but that's certainly the reality is really there. Yeah.
Well, welcome to the modern theater.
Yeah, right.
Nadeem, are you a modern Muslim?
Yeah, I think so. I think I joined the others and not being totally sure what that means or what it is to, I don't know, what trappings or what actions or what identity makes one modern. I share Sebastian's fear of technology, except I embrace it and it scares the crap out of me. You know, I mean, I have a device in my pocket that is more powerful than any computer I used, you know, 3 years ago, and let alone rocket ships from the 90s that went into space and came back. So we have this incredible power, but it was built in mines that are unsustainable with slave labor and children's hands and all kinds of things that are toxic to the earth and to society, and now I have to say, you know, in my relationship with God and my relationship with other people, that somehow I'm capable of measuring the, like, moral utility of the decision to buy and use this. That, like, this somehow is offset by the good deeds I will do with it, and that I'm equipped to make that decision. I think what makes me a modern Muslim is that I'm completely unequipped to make that decision. Mm. I'm totally going along for the ride. I'm buying the house. I'm taking the loan. I'm getting the education. I'm bought in. And it's not working for me. Mm. And it's not working for most Americans. Mm-hmm. And that is an American problem. It's a modern American problem of kind of trying your best and realizing that you're one market, you know, blip away from losing your house or losing mm-hmm. your job or losing your pension or just one Panama Papers leak away from mm-hmm. realizing that your boss is, you know, in bed with the devil or something. And it's like, these are things that are normal now mm-hmm. and have been happening probably continuously for the last 20 or 30 years that really call into question what it is to live a moral, productive American lifestyle. And I don't think that Muslims are grappling with those questions any differently. I do think it helps to have a moral code that we can check back to. Mm-hmm. All I know is I'm not doing very well. Mm-hmm. And I don't know how other people figure out the utility and the marks and the progress that they make on a moral standard in their own lives. But I can tell you that it seems like we're all struggling.
Mm. Welcome to the modern world. I know in my tradition, we differentiate in Christianity between the modern Christian and the postmodern Christian. And the postmodern Christian would be someone such as you who suggests, well, we can't live this way anymore, so let's move past the modern into what's next, sustainability and equality, and let's see how we can enter into dialogue to achieve that. So I'm a postmodern Christian. No one asked, but I'm asking myself what kind of Christian. I'm a postmodern Christian.
And can I just say that the religion says, right, basically, it'll be increasingly difficult to live a moral life over time, and, like, watch out and good luck. So I don't think there's a lot of solutions in there for us, but it's a known thing that each generation gets more complex and more difficult to measure and understand where you're at and how you're doing. Mm-hmm. And the very difficulty of the measurement and the very fact that was known, for me, I think deepens my faith and deepens some of the religious conversations I have both internal to the religion and kind of at large in the community.
Which leads nicely into my next question. We'll start back with you, Barbara, if you don't mind. What challenges do you face each day in your work and in your personal life?
As a Muslim or just as a human being?
I need you to decide where you want to go with that. Because you're a human being first.
Of course. Well, I'll leave aside the challenges that we all face just in terms of, you know, getting through the day and paying the bills and making those choices about what to do with our time. And as a Muslim, I guess the biggest challenge I face is about all the imagined ways that we are portrayed, we Muslims are portrayed in the media, which has become so ingrained, I think, in the majority of the public's mind that it's no longer even questioned, that it's just taken for granted. That we can hear words like Muslim terrorist or Islamic extremism and things like that, and just they register, and there's a picture in the receiver's mind that includes all Muslims. And I think this is very dangerous and very frightening for everyone, not just for Muslims. I think this is creating a really toxic atmosphere that we're all living in, we're breathing it, we're just subject to it all the time. And for me as a Muslim, that is a huge challenge. And it's one that I'm, you know, engaged every day in trying to find creative ways to push back against that. And I think what we're all doing here today is part of that. It's very much aligned with that, that yes, engaging with people, yes, being willing to meet a person on the street with a box of donuts and coffee, or to say yes to invitations. These are the ways that I personally choose to meet those challenges. Mm-hmm. Because the option is, the alternative is just, you know, go hide under a rock somewhere and just mm-hmm. feel miserable.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you.
Mona, we know you're a new mother of a two-year-old. So what challenges do you face each day in your life? I mean, in your work and in your personal life?
So my son is not only just two, he's two going on 20. I mean, like full-blown personality and, you know, the whole deal. I mean, the word no is just, he loves it. And it's hard for me because I'm not like a no mom. And so that's definitely been a challenge, certainly, in the last 2 years. But more than anything, that has been a blessing in my life. The real challenges have come from, you know, giving up more of my so-called career as a performance poet since becoming a mother. And, you know, just in the last, I would say, 6 months to a year, realizing that I can be both a mother and a performance poet, that I don't have to give up everything in order to be, like, the kind of mother I hope to be, and that I'm striving to be every single day. And you know, one of the real challenges that I often don't talk about in this very public sphere is the fact that I am a spiritual creature. I'm a spiritual being, and I since becoming a mother, I've really given up a lot of my spiritual practices, like meditation and like you know, having a mantra and practicing that mantra, and just so missing that and craving that and seeking it again and coming awake again to that, the fact that I want that back in my life and that I need that for myself in order to be the kind of mother I wish to be, and seeking that, and that's been you know, a challenge also turned to a blessing. And you know, that I'm deeply engaged in those conversations and those challenges at every moment, and weighing, you know, I could talk about all the challenges that we faced since doing the Ask a Muslim thing, you know, but that would just take up so much time, just the Facebook messages and, you know, just the general negativity directed at me as, you know, this 27-year-old Muslim woman, you know, kind of taking on the face, being the face of Islam for so many people because of an NPR piece and a, you know, television segment, and just how much that's affected me as a human and as a woman, and you know, people kind of just see me as this thing without feelings, and I think that's been a real challenge is to not be seen in the fullness of my humanity, and you know, that I too am a person who has feelings, and that, you know, words injure, and even if they are words typed on a screen that I'm just staring at in reading, you know, that is injurious. And so, you know, those challenges have been real too. And you know, I'm so grateful to have a spiritual practice that I can lean into when those challenges come to be so great. So I'm definitely stepping back more into that. And it's a challenge to do that, yeah.
Thank you. Also, a father of a two-year-old has many challenges. But what challenges do you face each day in your work and in your personal life?
Yeah. Our son is actually with a babysitter for the very first time tonight. So if we seem more neurotic than usual, it's like, anyway, the poor woman is like, everything's going to be fine. I will answer this kind of in the context of this event, because one of the big awakenings for me really in the last 6 to 12 months has been as a Muslim, and coming into this faith from the background that I talked a little bit about. You know, when Mona and I met, we met in 2012, and I would say at that time, anti-Muslim sentiment was probably at an all-time low, at least since 9/11. You know, it had been, you know, over 10 years since the attacks on 9/11. No one had really heard of ISIS. The civil war in Syria was still kind of this just one crazy man's mission to destroy his country. And, you know, I know Mona got looks and all these things, but it didn't seem like such a big deal. We'd be out in public, and we kind of enjoyed looking different from each other and looking, you know, at least Mona looking different than the kind of, you know, typical American woman. And we kind of enjoyed that. And we had no problems praying in the corner of an airport or on a grassy field when we were driving across the country. And it's not like we were just oblivious to the dangers, but it just, the tone at that time, the feeling in the country was just very, very different. Cut to today, this is kind of why we are here today and why you're putting on this forum, is things have really changed. And I think the biggest awakening and challenge for me has really been having to look at 40 plus years of being a white, college-educated, straight, able-bodied white man in this world for whom the doors just swing open wherever you go. You know, any restaurant you go into, there's a table waiting for you with white napkins and somebody willing to serve you, no questions asked. Any store you go into, people are willing to help you. No one's suspecting you of shoplifting or any of these other things. No one's moving away from you on the bus, any of these things. And I kind of thought I was very educated about these things. You know, I studied the civil rights in high school and college and thought I was this good Cambridge liberal guy who kind of understood all these things. But I really didn't until you walk down the street, you know, and I don't mean to say my experience has been anything like Mona's or other hijabis or other people, but getting the taste of discrimination and just getting the taste of what it's like to be different and to walk down the street with someone who wears the hijab and to see the looks, or to see me come into a store, have me come into a store and interact with somebody, and then Mona comes and joins me and sees how things change, was just a huge awakening. And I thought I really understood these things, and I did it, and I feel very humbled by that. And so the biggest challenge for me has been kind of reckoning, what does it mean, and what does it mean to kind of, in some ways, willingly give up some of that privilege, and at the same time, I can kind of be an undercover Muslim, right? I'm not dressing like a Muslim man right now. I'm not wearing a long thobe and growing my beard long and carrying around like a shepherd's stick or whatever people's ideas are. So I can kind of be undercover when I'm not with Mona, but also not wanting to kind of betray my faith and not wanting to, like, you know, choose sides. And there's a real temptation to want to do that. Be like, oh, well, I don't really want to be Muslim right now because I just don't want you to yell at me and I don't want you to, you know, have these things. And so that I think for me has been a challenge. And I think particularly with my family, who I don't think, like, I'm not really interested in that identity. I'm not interested in changing my identity. A lot of Muslim men and women change their names when they convert, and I just was never really interested in that. And I totally respect people who do. I think that's cool. But at the same time, I do want to faithfully represent this path that I've chosen and be an ambassador, and yet I can feel that temptation to kind of, you know, not really raise my hand. If someone's like, all the Muslims in the room raise their hand, I'm gonna kind of wait till there's a few other people before I, you know. So that has really been part of my inner journey and really looking at white privilege in a way that I never have before, and it's been embarrassing and humiliating and challenging, and I'm looking at my country in ways that I hadn't before. These things that used to be very abstract have become more real, you know, recently. And I really thank Mona for going on that ride with me and for introducing me to a world in which that things are really more complicated than they used to be, at least for me. So that's the kind of path I'm on.
Thank you. Nadeem?
So many challenges. you know, I'd say in the civic space, of course, everyone I work with is totally nonviolent, but is totally overwhelmed by the difficulty of trying to get their thoughts across and trying to make a dent on the system, a fundamentally broken, sometimes inertially stagnant system. So my challenge is finding and training volunteers, finding and training employees, and then ultimately finding and training in myself this difficulty lobbying consistently, gently, kindly, when the stakes are so high. One could look at Trump or Cruz or campaign finance problems or any host of things that have been present and egregious for a long time and say, these have to change tomorrow. I'm going to yell about it. And generally, protests are helpful. They definitely focus a lot of energy and a lot of attention, a lot of press on things. But the real change is being done by lobbyists who are paid to do something usually self-serving, often. And they know the game, and it really is a game for them and for a lot of the politicians as well. It's fun, it's rewarding, it's lucrative. And there's rules to the game. And my challenge is figuring out what all the rules are, how best to convey them. And then when you realize that the rules are about consistency, about coalition building, about kindness, about a genteel approach, even when the stakes are high, and you have to actually convey that to someone who wants change tomorrow, mm-hmm. or who hasn't been consistently involved in civics or in community impact, but wishes to be, fitting a bunch of square pegs, all of us, people who want change and deserve it, into round holes, people who get change but don't deserve it. That is often a difficult endeavor, and certainly is one of the things I think about and struggle with most.
Thank you. And then one more question that we've been discussing in the Interfaith Center this week, so bear with us. We talk about everything in the Interfaith Center. And one big topic has been Islamophobia. What does that term really mean? It means fear of something. So do you get a pass if you're just afraid? Do bigots get a pass and they can call it Islamophobia? Or I'm afraid of spiders. I'm just afraid. So when do we need to call bigotry bigotry and I'll use the word anti-Semitism, please disagree with me, instead of it's a fear of, but it's a hatred, which is a vastly different thing. So what we've been discussing a lot today in the Interfaith Center was the question, what would each of you briefly say to someone who seeks to understand Islam for the very first time? Brief response. I'll give you a brief response from a person at Quran study today. She said, our religion is not what you hear in the media. So, I ask you briefly for your last question before we open it up to the audience. What would you say to someone seeking to understand Islam for the very first time? What's the core? What's the secret?
I would say first, in response to calling the phenomenon Islamophobia, that we've already passed that. It's no longer fear of Islam. It is anti-Muslim hatred of Islam and Muslims. Mm-hmm. So we're definitely there. But I would say what I would want someone to know is that I believe in God, the God of Abraham and Moses and Jesus and Muhammad. It is one and the same. I believe that these were individuals selected by God, along with many other prophets, to guide human beings to live ethical lives for our benefit, not to punish us in any way, and that there were scriptures that were given to certain of the prophets. And that they all came from the same source, namely the one God. And so right there, we have a whole common ground that I think maybe most people in this audience hadn't considered before. So that's where I would start.
Thank you, Barbara. That's a great place to start. Mona, where would you start?
Well, I would so ditto that, first of all. And I would add to that list, you know, Krishna and the Buddha and all the sages and wisdom keepers and, you know, prophets whose names we knew and whose names, you know, we didn't know. And, you know, it's really funny because Vanity Fair Italia actually just did a thing on us, and it came out yesterday. And I was really unhappy because I spent like 2-3 hours talking to them, and it ended up being this like teeny tiny column. But one of the things that it did for me was that it really helped me hone in on my personal language. And they asked this very question. And what I said was, Islam is the ultimate awakening of consciousness to the truth that we are constantly interbeing with all creatures, beings, and things that exist in the universe in the light and love of the One. Because ultimately, I do believe that, and that is the way Islam for me expresses itself in my everyday life, is to see my total interconnectedness with all of you and with the walls and the trees and all that I can see and all that I can't see at every single moment.
Thank you for that poetry. Sebastian?
I'm so glad the women are going first. It just makes our life so much easier and subverting the whole stereotype. It's great.
We organized it.
That's great. I just want to share a little anecdote. The very first time we did the booth, we were out in front of the library in Cambridge, and you know, we had no idea what we were doing, and so it was Mona and me and our son, and so Mona takes her son inside, and I'm standing outside, and actually two of Nadeem's friends, I wanted some backup. We just were really afraid the first time. One guy is redder hair than me, and there's a third white dude, and we're standing there, and you know, we got this kind of like, people would come up and they'd look, it says, ask a Muslim, talk to a Muslim, and they're kind of like, you know, looking at the sign and looking at us and looking at the sign, they're like, well, who's the Muslim? And I'm like, oh, that's me, you know? And I had this fantasy that then the next thing they would say was, they'd look at me like, you're Muslim? And I'm like, yeah, I'm Muslim. And they'd be like, oh, I'm not Islamophobic, I'm just racist, thank you. You know, and they'd hug me and they'd come to this big racial awakening, because just like you said, I think this whole Islamophobia is complete garbage. It's just thinly veiled racism. It's thinly veiled bigotry, and that's all that it is. And it's acceptable to say, I'm Islamophobic. It's acceptable to say, oh, I'm afraid of immigrants, I'm afraid of terrorists. Who's not afraid of terrorists, right? That's okay to say. It's not okay to say, well, I just don't really feel comfortable with people who don't look like me. I just don't really feel comfortable with brown people. I just don't really feel comfortable with Arab people or Asian people or people from Africa, you know? And that's the conversation that's not happening, you know? And I don't know if a lot of people know, a third of Muslims in America are African American, right? So there's this sort of built-in double whammy going on. So I completely agree. It goes far beyond kind of a fear. It's a really deep-seated racial thing that we're just not addressing. And I'd say, to kind of answer that question, for me, the reason I came to Islam, the reason I came to embrace Islam was through people. You know, it wasn't through debate. It wasn't through interfaith dialogue. It wasn't through hearing statistics about, well, did you know that, you know, most of the last Nobel Peace Prize winners were Muslim? And did you know how educated the Muslim world is? And do you know the advances of science and technology that Islam has brought to the world? All of which are true, by the way. Statistics don't really go very far. It was heart connection. It was a friend of mine who converted at the age of 16. It was meeting his parents. It was living in New Mexico and meeting other people and ultimately meeting Mona. And I think that's where change happens. And so I would say to people who want to understand Islam, you know, great, if you want to read the Quran, wonderful, you know, and if you want to see these interesting documentaries, but talk to people and see how their lives are both interesting and banal and boring and just as interesting and lame as yours, and suddenly all these fears and misconceptions kind of melt away, and judge it through that heart kind of personal connection first, and then do all that great research and become an ally. So.
Thank you. Nadeem.
I can say that I was ahead of the game in calling racism racism.
Oh, good.
Like 10 years ago, I was on radio as the president of the Muslim Students Association at MIT, and I was on with someone who had done interfaith with my father when I was young. And at some point, this guy went to Israel-Palestine, and at some point he said something to the effect of, obviously, given the genetic predisposition for violence of the Palestinian people, blah, blah, blah. And I was like, that's racism. And everyone in the booth was like, oh, because I had said that was racism, not because the person had just been racist, right? 10 years later, we're all, you know, post-Obama, post-racial America, we all hope that we can point at racism and call a spade, but it's weird to me that in 2006, something blatantly racist couldn't be acknowledged by the radio host, a very prominent priest in the room, and the person themselves. And this is what we contend with. It's definitely racism happening. It's definitely bigotry. There's also an element of fascism that creeped in for the first time in a while. Mm. Like, I wanted to say that the hawkish stance of Congress and many of our past presidents has been fascist. But you don't know real fascism until a presidential candidate says we should round people up and patrol Muslim neighborhoods. And it's like,
put a sign.
bonkers. So
that's where we are. In terms of what would you say to someone who wants to understand Islam for the first time, I think I totally agree with everything my colleagues on the panel have said, but for me, the way I articulate it, and the way I articulate, I guess, coming to understand almost any way, any traditional way, is walking this very narrow, very fraught, very confusing line between humbleness on one side and ego on the other side, between the realization that we have a huge amount of duty, moral compulsion, and a will to make good in the world, and then this knowledge that nothing we do will actually matter, like this fatalistic instinct that we're a tiny, insignificant piece of the universe, and one day the star that guides our particular solar system will explode, and humans will be off in some other, either part of the galaxy, or will have destroyed society and the environment. But like, we are this tiny, infinitesimal piece right now, each soul, each person. And the fact that you have to go through this journey and you only have like 80 years, if you're lucky, to figure out how to balance this compulsion with this reality, and you have to stay sane while you're doing it, this to me is the fundamental basis of all wise teachings. And Islam is one such inspired wise teaching, and I believe it gives one balance and it gives one insight into walking the path. And for me, it really helps me understand, on one hand, how I have to navigate my civic obligations towards improving society, and on the other hand, how I can come to terms with that when it's not successful. The humbleness, the kind of fatalism, the fact that it doesn't have to work for us to be doing our duty correctly. Mm-hmm. If that makes sense.
So thank you very much.
Let's take some questions. Folks, just a reminder, please don't ask any questions from your seat. You need to walk up to the microphone and speak into it so that the video can catch you and so that other people can hear you. If you prefer not to stand up, I am still live tweeting this event. If you look at hashtag FHF, if you want to send your question, tweet your question to hashtag FHF, I am happy to say it here.
Can we tweet our answers if we're shy?
Yes,
Yeah, I don't see why
might.
Not.
Okay.
That seems fair.
Can I just add something to what we were saying earlier? You know, this interesting conversation between Islamophobia and anti-Semitism and the delineation between the two and how we see them as very separate in our very binary views of, you know, just the political issue of Palestine and Israel. And I don't want to get into all that. But I am a Semite.
That's what I'm saying.
Ethnically, I am a Semite. So anti-Semitism, as expressed by so-called Islamophobia, is still anti-Semitism to me as a Semite, as a Semitic woman. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I just want to put that out there. If we're talking about words and all these different interesting intersections and intersectionality of who we are as people, well, here I am, a Semitic woman, and mm-hmm. I have feelings, and people hate me for being Semitic, you know, and that's something that we need to be talking about.
And that's what we're talking about.
Yeah.
That's my point.
Okay. Thank you.
Hmm. Well, we just heard the word fascism introduced here to describe certain people. You must know that Islamofascism is also a term, so I guess it's okay to say Islamofascism if we can call other people who we don't like fascist also.
What's your
as far question? As the term anti-Semite goes, you know that the term was specifically invented to describe
What's
anti-Jewishness.
Your
so your attempt to take over the language is also interesting.
What's
now, the
question?
Real reason for so-called Islamophobia is because of the violence we've seen around the world, not only 9/11, but what's going on in Europe and here, perpetrated by those who claim to be acting in the name of Islam. Mm-hmm. We've seen shocking polls which show that 30, 35, 40% of young Muslims in various countries in Europe approve of suicide bombing. People see these polls, they watch. In this country, perhaps 15 or 20% of young male Muslims in their 20s, perhaps, maybe into the early 30s, are also approving of suicide bombing. Americans see this, and they don't like it. And I would suggest that this is a reason for the violence. Now, as far as any personal attack, any and he slurs, any insults, any physical attacks on anybody because of their religion should be condemned. But you folks should do more to condemn the violence perpetrated in the name of your religion. And finally, with regards to your prophet, so-called, can you please tell me how it is that you admire, you worship someone who was a bloodthirsty, murdering, rampaging maniac, a genocidal maniac who slaughtered anybody who got in his way?
Can I just interrupt for a second? Because, excuse me, what you're doing right now is exactly what we are, why we are here tonight, and I think it's why the rest of the audience is here tonight. And you've got a lot of interesting ideas there that would take a lot, much more time than we have to answer. But I think we can all agree with at least one of your points that violence towards any group should be condemned. So, thank you.
Also, your numbers are so wildly off, and even if they weren't, I mean, a recent poll showed a ridiculous number of Americans don't know who the vice president is. The economy didn't collapse after that poll was revealed. And in the same way, people who will be polled in any European poll or people who have ridiculous aggressive values, these people will be healed with communication and with dialogue and with righteousness. And righteousness is nonviolent. And we are all doing the work of speaking out against violence consistently. It is not your place to ask us to do more. It is your place to continue to heal through dialogue. And I can promise you that the way in which you are revealing your intentions and your positions is not going to heal anyone.
I mean.
And just one response, if you do want to talk about numbers, there are 1.6 billion Muslims in the world, and statistically it's been studied. The percentage of Muslims who are even pro-violence, okay, so any Muslim who not just commits violence, but is pro-violence, like you mentioned, that number would be 0.006%. Statistically insignificant, according to all theories, all people who study statistics, all research. It's an insignificant number, but what we have is a media that focuses on those people. And what we don't have is a media that focuses on the lives of black Muslims, on the lives of Iraqi and Afghani Muslims who have been slaughtered in the masses. You know, hundreds of thousands, if not millions, and now in Syria and in other places. So I think violence is a human problem. It's not a religious problem, it's a human problem. And until we stop calling it a religious problem and come together as a human family to try to figure out why we keep hurting each other, there won't be healing.
Hi, I really appreciate the openness and kindness that you guys are all bringing tonight. Going into this Islamophobia a little bit more, how do you guys at a personal level relate to these events? I mean, do you look at stuff across the world and say, gosh, they're doing it wrong? Or like, I mean, where did they go so wrong?
Can I just clarify when you say they?
Any one of the number of events that the last gentleman mentioned, I mean, you know, the subjugation of women, the violence, the stuff that we see in the media, the terrible, terrible acts.
Where does subjugation of women come from in general? You know, where does the pay gap come from, the wage gap? Or, you know, where does this idea that trickle-down economics was ever going to work? Or that we should fund the Defense Department better than the Department of Education? I mean, where do these offensive ideas come from in society, and why aren't Americans immune to them? You know, I don't know. Why does oppression exist? I can't answer that, but I have to ask another question in response. Why is it weird for the other gentleman or for anyone else that Muslims struggle with a journey, a temporal epochal journey, where the religion evolves somewhat, where its constituents evolve somewhat, Why is it strange that that journey has righteousness, has difficulty, has pain, has glory, the same way that any other religion or ethnic group would? And maybe does it seem to you like Muslims are grappling with this more than others? Because historically speaking, I actually think that most traditions have grappled with this issue at different times, and that we actually know the pattern of that liberal progressive movement within religions and around religions. So I actually don't think any of these conversations are that confusing or that new, if that's fair to say. And I want to be appreciative of your question, but I also think you probably already have most of the answers.
Mm-hmm. And I want to say thank you for your question and the invitation to speak on that. And just to say that, you know, as a Muslim on a trajectory towards a path that I see directing me towards an enlightenment, you know, if I follow it properly and correctly, and people who are violent, I see them as off that path. That violence is not ultimately any kind of awakening. That people who enact that are not on that path towards knowing the other by, you know, knowing the self by knowing the other. That's an integral part of Islam. And if you're not doing that, if you're being violent, if you can hurt the other, then you don't really understand the path, right? And so I really encourage young Muslims to study their tradition, because when you've studied and steeped yourself in the depths of this tradition, you are vehemently anti-violent. You just are. You're anti-violent by nature, because this path tells us to be. And so my invitation to young Muslims is not leave Islam at the door and join modernity, you know, join, you know, everybody else in doing what's right and being pro-justice and stand up for, you know, for everybody who's oppressed. My invitation is study your path, because it will give you tools to, you know, to remove the shackles that let us see, you know, another person as another person and not just ourself, you know. So I see them as off the path, yes, I do. And, you know, we can talk about misogyny for days and days. Mm. You know, that's, again, a human problem. Every 9 seconds, a woman in the United States is abused by a partner. 1 in 3 women is abused by her partner in this country. Misogyny is a human problem that we all need to come together to fight and combat. And the Muslim world is no stranger to that problem.
Okay, I have to share a little bit of my ignorance, because I would have come to see you with your donuts and coffee, and I would have asked this question. It's a little redundant from what you just said, but when we see the media portraying ISIS, namely, I'm going to be very specific, committing unspeakable acts, as acts of war are, but these are really graphic, especially the way they're portrayed. Has that got anything to do with Islam?
Yeah. Question.
I mean, they've named themselves Islamic. Right. But that doesn't mean that they're representing Islam. Mm-hmm. And from what I understand of the religion of Islam, it has nothing at all to do with terrorism. Mm-hmm. There's a saying of Prophet Muhammad that says, the best person is the one that benefits other people. Mm-hmm. There is no benefit in harming innocent people. No benefit whatsoever, no matter what the motivation might be. And so no, they don't represent the Islam that I know, and I'm sure that I speak for the others up here, and for the vast majority of Muslims. In fact, the majority of victims of ISIS and other terror groups are Muslims themselves. So I think, again, we go back to language. To continue to refer to these people by their chosen name is misleading to everybody.
So am I right in hearing that everybody on the stage, on the forum, doesn't see any deep theological basis in Islam for jihadis and these kinds of movements?
300 to 600 Islamic scholars, people who have dedicated their lives to the study of theology and religion, mm-hmm. And are Muslim theologians and scholars and sheikhs and imams from all over the world gathered a few months ago, and they put out this huge document, pages and pages and pages, of how un-Islamic Daesh is. Because calling them ISIS is like me changing my birth certificate to Homer Simpson. It's ridiculous. I'm not Homer Simpson. I could never be Homer Simpson. I'm not yellow enough. Whatever. You know, it wouldn't work, you know? But like, we continue to call them the Islamic State because that's what they've called themselves, and they're foolish criminals. They're criminals. They're violent, foolish criminals who've taken this religion and twisted it to meet their own violent agendas.
If I can jump in, almost every autocrat in history has used whatever the religion of the day is to manifest their greed and their control. And that's true even for secular states that use whatever form of capitalism, communism, or socialism is popular in the day. They shake off the shackles of religion, and then they use their new religion in order to punish people equally. So I would tend to say that, just like some of the prior questions, that these patterns are not new to us. And we have seen them all over Latin America. Heck, we've participated in helping autocrats use whatever the religion of the day is to oppress people. And Central Asia and Latin America are great examples. Throughout the 80s, 90s, and even today. So I don't know how to say this politely. There is a certain amount of scrutiny and self-analysis that can be done now to put violence in its own box and to stop associating violence with the other. And the flavor of the month this month is Muslims. Last month it was black people in the inner city. You know, the month before that it was some other thing. And my feeling is that we all have the equipment now to make these decisions individually and collectively and move on to the human conversation that Mona wanted to have about how to improve society together.
I really appreciate your question. And I think, you know, one of the things we risk in this time is being vulnerable, right, and asking those difficult questions. So I just want to say thank you. I just want to share a little anecdote. We were in Washington, D.C. a week and a half ago for a conference, which if there's time, I'd love to just share something about. But I don't know if you guys know, there was an event in front of the White House. This guy was waving a gun around, and he was quoting Romans or something from the New Testament, you know, that some passage that basically affirmed his lawlessness and affirmed his immunity from sovereign law or something like that. Now, when we hear something like that, what do we think? Must be crazy. Like, this guy's in front of the White House, he's waving a gun around. We don't think, we really should look a little closer at those Christians. You know, I mean, they're really, you know, we just think he's crazy. He's obviously, I mean, what kind of nut? At the very least, he's risking getting himself thrown in prison for a long time and committing a federal crime and all these things. But we just automatically do that, right? That guy is crazy. But as soon as somebody stands up and claims the moniker of being Muslim, well, suddenly they come to speak for that religion and come to speak. And I think that becomes very dangerous. And I think, you know, no one scrutinizes the KKK for being Christian. I mean, they're about as Christian as Daesh is Muslim,
and
right?
And actually what we do for the KKK, by not giving them the kind of recognition that they want, is, you know, kind of saying that they are just crazy.
We silence them.
By focusing on ISIS the way we are, it is kind of like this weird, shiny thing. Everybody's like, ooh, shiny. Let's look at that some more. Let's talk about it some more. And I'm not saying we shouldn't talk about it. But what I'm saying is by emphasizing and overemphasizing and focusing on it, it's creating kind of giving them more power than they should even, God forbid that they have any more power.
Press
or media or any of that.
So I was just wondering, like, dealing with all the abuse and Islamophobia and all of that, especially stuff like that first horribly offensive comment, how do you stay, like, calm and kind and, like, just kind of keep your humanity in your heart? Because I was sitting there listening to that, and I was just, like, pissed off. Like, I was mad. But you all seem to handle it very well, so I was just wondering, like, how do you cope with that kind of stuff? Like, I'm still mad about it. You can't tell.
I think that was a great snapshot for all of you, in case you didn't know what Islamophobia looked like. So there it is. And honestly, it's based on ignorance, or else it's based on willful ignorance. I think the vast majority of people really are ignorant about Islam, and there are studies that show that, you know, maybe 6% of Americans consider themselves knowledgeable about Islam, and so they're very susceptible to all this sort of propaganda that's out there. Mm-hmm. But then there are other people who really don't want to know. They have a different agenda, and they are willfully ignorant, and they're trying to bring others along with them. And so what do you do in the face of ignorance? If people want to enlighten themselves, the door's open. There's many avenues to gain understanding and information. But for those who don't, no, it's sort of a losing battle.
I've tried to go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say the Quran is actually the way, I use the Quran to, you know, as my tool to when I encounter things like that. And the Quran specifically says, and when those who have ignorance in their hearts address you, reply to them with peace. You know, that's the only way. And honestly, to take that even a step further, the Quran talks about that and says that if you have somebody who not only is ignorant about you, but willfully is ignorant and hates you, that you should go out of your way and give that person a gift. And that by giving that person a gift, like a physical act, like a present, like wrap it up and put a bow on it, and give that person a present. And when you do that, that person becomes, like, the Quran uses the word like warm, like a warm ally, like a deep friend, like a bosom friend, you know. I don't know, do people say that anymore? Bosom, like, yeah. Anne of Green Gables. I grew up on Anne of Green Gables, sorry. Anyway, like, you know, I take my religion seriously, and that's what it tells me to do, is to respond with that which is more beautiful, which is another instruction of the Quran. So to address hatred with more hatred, or with address hatred with anger, there's only more negativity. And I don't know, I know a lot of people who see energies, okay, and I don't think that they're crazy. And that they see, like, energies kind of, like, swirling around people, and they're these beautiful and really, like, amazing human beings. And one of the things that they see is that when negativity joins together, all you have is more negativity. You have more negativity that's swirling around, right? So instead of producing more negativity, you neutralize it with love, right? That's the only thing I can think to do, is to take all of the hurt in the world and say, I'm sorry that there's hurt, and how can I help to heal it and remedy it and make it better? What can I do? Can I give you a present?
I swing back and forth between having kind of a long history of, I think, being pretty gentle in my responses and trying to adopt the same mentality. And more recently, I'm experimenting with a very dangerous drug, assertiveness. can lead to aggressiveness, can lead to even more dangerous places. But I found that in being really frank in my responses, I can first demand respect and then have a kind of fraught factual conversation. And then when everyone's exhausted 10 minutes later, generally I can understand and I will find that even very difficult people will want to communicate what's really bothering them. I think at that point, if you can get there, and it's not everyone, if you can get there through a safe level of assertiveness, that I've found that people will not only give you a piece of what's really bothering them, and sometimes it's something that sounds very racist, or sometimes it's ignorance, but sometimes it's like something very personal and historical in nature, that it helps you actually, you know, create that bridge more substantively. And very often they take something of you as well. Listen, I hear you. I hear what you're saying. I totally disagree with you. Now that we're calmed down a little bit, here's how I would look at the problem you're having, and you can either take it or leave it. And I find some people taking it. Thank you.
I just wanted to share, this is the anecdote moment I was looking for. Sorry, just be really quick. But we were at this conference in Washington, D.C. It was a two-day conference on the Quran, and it was scholars from all over the country, both talking about the book, but also modern applications. And one of the themes that several speakers addressed was trials and tribulations in the course of Islamic history and current time. And, you know, I kept waiting for people to talk about what a terrible time that we're living in, and talking about the Ted Cruzes and the Donald Trumps, and talking about Islamophobia, and talking about anti-Muslim sentiment, and talking, you know, all these things. and kind of getting defensive and how we have to go out. And I was just humbled and amazed that when those moments came up, instead of looking outward, what came up again and again is, and what we really need to do when trial comes is to look within, you know, to become a better person, to become more peaceful ourselves, to see how we ourselves are maybe committing any acts of violence, whether it's subtle, whether it's aggressive. I it's very humbling to the point of tears that the response from some of the most learned and most influential, speaking to almost 1,000 people, was to look within and to try to become a better person yourself. In the face of, you know, what some would just agree is just a really horrible, horrible time that we're living in. And you know, so I just wanted to share that as that's a very commonly adopted attitude and posture, and I think everybody kind of spoke to that in their own way. And the last thing, I've decided I can't read the comments section of any article that has the word Muslim in it, because it kept me up for like 3 days. I couldn't believe some of the things that people were saying, and Mona was very good. She said, don't worry about it. And I just have gotten to the point where I just get to the end of the article and I see all these comments and I just have to stop reading them. So everybody kind of copes in their own way.
We definitely have one question here, but just before you go, if you would still like to tweet a question, you're welcome to. It's hashtag FHF. Thanks, go ahead.
Okay, just to apologize ahead, I don't really have a question. I have a comment, I guess.
Oh, no.
It's okay, Miriam.
You're
going to
be offensive?
Oh, you go, Miriam.
Okay, so in my social change class, we were talking about privilege, like white privilege. And we did this little BuzzFeed experiment, and we had to write down like a number. She asked all these questions, like, and when I was finished, I ended up at 4 when there was 22 questions. And some people got like 24 out of 24, which is impossible. Somebody definitely cheated or something, you know. but my point is I always felt like I had privilege. You know, I always felt like I was very fortunate. I never felt like I was, you know, the thing in the corner or something, you know. You know, my experience, I'm married as well, and my husband is actually a convert, and he's Hispanic. So when we walk around or something, or holding hands, whatever, people look at us like we're so strange, which, you know, obviously he's a Muslim, you know, it's cool for us, but people are just like looking at us, and, you know, or me, for example, obviously I wear the hijab, and you have people take like full-on stops to look at you. And sometimes I wish like I can just wear like a question sign on my hijab. Mm. You know, I want people to ask me questions. I want to inform you. Like I actually do the Quran study. And so every week people like non-Muslims come and I just tell them my story and I just want to like inform them. Like, you know, I just want to tell them we're not as bad as you think. You know, I'm just like you. I'm a freshman trying to get through college, you know, trying to get my degree, going to grad school. You know, it just, you know, sometimes people look at Muslims and just exclude us in a way. Like, but okay, thank you. I guess I'm in this new cool club, you know, if you want to call it that. but yeah, and, you know, the hijab to me, this is like to everybody, you know. I wear the hijab because I want to. And, you know, when you think of modern Muslim, you're like, you know, I do feel like it is 2016. I could wear whatever I want, and everybody should be okay with it. You know, if somebody's going to have a problem with it, please come ask me and talk to me. Maybe I'll change your mind. You know, just like you said, like, if I can change one person's mind today, I feel so accomplished. You know, yeah, so back to the hijab. I wear the hijab because I want to. It's not because somebody's forcing me. It's not because I have to religiously, of course, but because I did it, you know, I started a year ago, and it's like the happiest thing in my life. You know, it was such a good decision. I wear it with pride, and yeah, sorry, that was my comment.
Thank you.
So we have 10 minutes left. Oh, we do have another question. Go ahead.
I heard Ali Hershey, that's not quite her name, but you know who I'm talking about, over in Cambridge. For those who don't know, maybe one of you could better describe her background, but she grew up in East Africa and ended up through complexity of movement through various countries and then the great immersion in her religion of Islam and a deep faith, departing from her faith and making her way to Europe. On the way to Canada, she jumped the train, so to speak, and made her way to Holland, and then was involved in the film that eventually led to the assassination of the man who created the film, and her life became at risk, and she got into Parliament in Holland and then needed a bodyguard 24/7 and came to the States, and she's been in Washington. She's written books. She's been in, with a think tank, a Republican think tank, I think. But she was speaking in Cambridge, and she was expressing her feeling, her point of view that the Quran is, and I don't have any depth of knowledge about the Quran, but the Quran is made up of two parts. The original part, which is sounds like that part of the outlook on life, responsibility, and faith, and so forth, that is loving and aimed at that sense of connectedness and peace and support and goodness and so forth. And then Muhammad going to Medina and wanting to spread the religion, and so promoting violence, promoting armed expansion of Islam. I mean, maybe like the Crusaders and Christianity or whatever.
Ma'am, I'm sorry, we so only do have a few minutes left. Could you tell us what your question is?
The question is, she went on to say that she firmly believes that Islam is a violent religion. This is her speaking, all right? And I'm sure you've heard this. It's a violent religion that that those who, and I don't happen to agree with what I heard, but this, just how do you respond to this? That it, there are the outwardly violent people, like the Islamists who are fighting, and ISIS, but then underneath it is this core motivation to take over the world. Islam wants to take over the world.
I'm sorry, is your question, do they agree with Ayaan Hirsi Ali on this?
Is this do you know what I'm talking about? This extraordinarily different point of view that I hadn't heard before now.
Yeah. So she is not a scholar by any means on anything that she talks about. She's a human being who's been wounded, deeply wounded by many things. And I think her trajectory into her woundedness really is a big part of her narrative that she doesn't talk about. You know, and I think if we all were a little more vulnerable and talked about our woundedness and where those wounds came from, we could all join that human family, you know, and engage in those very authentic and more honorable ways. So I think for someone to speak about the Quran at that level that she does, and she's quite prolific and writes about the Quran, I would really invite her and encourage her to study the Quran formally. And to take it upon herself to inform herself about what she does talk about, because it's historically sound knowledge that when the Prophet Muhammad went to Medina, it had nothing to do with arms and war and none of that. None of that was real. What he did was he adopted a more Jewish way because the Medinans were a more Jewish people, and the tribes in Medina were majority Jews, and so. When he went there, he adopted a new hairstyle because that's the way the Jewish men wore their hair. He assimilated, you know? And so you want to talk about differences, and I would really, someone like her, I would really encourage her just to study a little bit more and to take on, you know, the true scholarship if she wants to talk about these kinds of things.
I would just add very quickly that if anybody wants to understand more about Islam, understand where you're getting your sources of information from. Mm-hmm. If you wanted to understand more about democracy, you wouldn't go to someone who's anti-democracy.
Yeah, that's a good point.
You know, I'll leave it at that.
Thank you. That's a good point.
I'm in fourth grade, and I just wanted to know what to say to my classmates if they say something unfair about Muslims, and I don't know what to
that
say.
That is a great question.
That's a great question.
You taught fourth grade.
Yeah, I taught elementary school for a long time. I mean, so you just have met four Muslims, right? So you can certainly use us. We'll come to your classroom and we'll talk to those, whoever that is. But use your own experience, you know, and I would say put questions back on them, just like we did, you know, and again, thank you for your question. To put your question back on them, well, who did you hear that from? And do you know that that's true? And to really say, because it's just sort of like any offensive comment or any racist joke or anything, you know, it's just coming out of almost always out of a place of ignorance, right?
And bullying, you know, and bullying is real. In all through school, you find big time bullies. And when you come across a bully, even if they're just talking about Muslims, and you know, maybe you don't happen to be a Muslim, but you experience a comment as bullying, you say, hey, I don't think that that's very nice. You know, that doesn't make me feel good as a human, you know, as a person. I think you can share your feelings. And I think if we all shared our feelings a little bit more, we'd all be a little happier.
That's a good question.
And can I just say, you know, going back to the comment, somehow Islamophobia and Islamophobic comments have become acceptable, right? And I think it's also the kind of thing that educators are, you know, sort of likely to not either want to deal with or think are kind of benign. And so it's really incumbent on parents of children in school, of the children in school, to not just say something to those other students, but to say something to your teacher, to say something to your parent, to say something to your principal. There was a story that came out of Texas this week where a middle school teacher actually berated a student who was Muslim and said, you know that we all think you're a terrorist, and we know that, and the classmates really ganged up, and the school has put that teacher on leave and has yet to fire that teacher. Because again, these kind of things have become so commonplace that we miss them when they go by. So it's really up to the people.
Can you tell us your name?
I'm Anna Siepler.
Anna, can we give Anna a round of applause?
I'm curious, Anna, are there Muslim students in your class or in your school?
There's definitely some in my school, and my mom teaches, and I know a lot of Muslim friends, but I don't think there are any in my class.
Well, thank you, Anna, for standing up for what you think is right. Thank you.
Ditto.
Thank you.
Sure. This is our last question.
So I'm kind of in the opposite situation where, as you are, in that I deal with the racism all the time. Based on ignorance, I am not Muslim. But I, for lack of a better term, and it's a horrible term to use, I deal with the fallout when events happen of people stopping me in the street, people making comments. Which is great for me because I'm actually half German and studied German and had to study a lot of German history. So I've had an interesting time lately when people tend to make comments discussing historically where we're heading ever since the Patriot Act. For dealing with things like this. And I'm wondering, do you ever get to that point in a discussion with people about just to say to them, do you realize what you're saying and where we're heading with a lot of the comments that are coming up in terms of rounding people up, having them wear badges, making sure we know neighborhoods, having places where you can go to without being charged for anything just on the basis of actual racism.
Right. You're asking me?
I'm asking all of you. I think it's probably easier for you, but I'm curious, is there a point where you can actually have discussions with people about that type of thing, or is it much more baseline, hi, I'm not, you know?
Yeah.
I think it's possible, but what I wanna talk about is something that's not quite your question, but I was almost surprised when this media cycle happened around the Republican presidential nominees. And then I just wasn't very rapidly. I was like, oh yeah, of course this was gonna happen. We have journalists who don't do as much investigative journalism. They're forced to do more work with lower quality, and they know it, and they lament it. And then now you have a media cycle where people are feeding into Trump, and where voters don't have the education or the context as voters to look for anything other than exposure. So all Trump is going for is more ridiculous statements. All the media is doing is covering him more every time he escalates. And all voters are doing is showing up to receive more Trump more of the time. And of course, the outcome is that Trump does well, irrespective of what the content is. Yeah. It's just a matter of exposure. So the conversation I am having is, do you really support Trump? And the realization many people have is, I guess not really. I just am upset about things.
Right.
And if we can get to that point, actually, we're all upset about things, and likely the same things. Trump wants to talk about some of the urgent things that are urgent on the right. But immigration is actually urgent to all of us. Security is urgent to all of us. International geopolitical affairs are urgent to all of us. And if anyone who supports Trump actually puts down their priorities and then looks at his qualifications, they find it very difficult to support the man. And I guess my point is I find it not that difficult to get into substantive conversations like that in order to get back to basics and get back to sanity. My problem is I just can't do it with like 30 million people at a time.
Yeah. Well, I think we've come to the end of our conversation, and I want to thank all of you for being here on behalf of Suffolk University, particularly the Interfaith Center. And I would like to say to you, salam. Peace be with you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.